Good morning, LCC. Welcome to the Sunday morning service here at the Fort.
Morning.
We hope that you had a blessed week in the Lord.
Amen.
Happy NFL Sunday.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, here at the Fort, here at LCC, we have a passion for Christ, a purpose for living, and a power of witness. Really quick, brothers and sisters, I want to tell you about my team. Okay? My team has been around for more than 2,000 years.
There you go.
Okay?
Amen.
My team only has three members. One, two, three.
Father, Son, Holy Spirit. There you go.
My team has never lost.
That's right.
Brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce you to my team.
Yes.
God the Father.
There you go.
God the Son.
That's right.
God the Holy Spirit.
There he is.
Better known as the Trinity.
There you go. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, our scripture reading this morning will be coming from the NIV version of the Bible, the New Testament book of Matthew, a well-known verse, chapter 28, verses 19 through 20. Again, NIV version of the Bible, New Testament, book of Matthew, chapter 28, verses 19 through 20. And the powerful Lord, the word of the Lord, says this: Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all the things I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Let God add his blessing to the readers, the doers, and the hearers of his holy word. Amen. Let's bow our head and go before the Father in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing us here to this day. Thank you for allowing us to come before you once again, Lord. Father, we know that our Super Bowl is in heaven. So, Lord God, we ask that your blessing be upon our beloved pastor, awesome pastor, First Lady LCC congregation, and brothers and sisters around the world. Father God, I need you. We need you. Help us, Lord. Help us.
Amen.
That we might live a life that's worthy of your blessing.
Yes, amen.
And Lord God, we love you. Lord God, we thank you. And Lord God, we give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. In Jesus' name we pray and we thank you. Let's put our hands together as our powerful and awesome praise team come before us to sing.
Amen. To God be all glory. How are y'all glad you're on the winning team? Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Let's take it back to the old school church real quick here. We're going to bless his name. How many know the name of Jesus? It means something to us. Hallelujah.
Jesus,
today, Father, we worship you. We magnify your name. Hallelujah. We worship you. Yeah. We give you the glory.
Bless your name.
How many know the Lord God Almighty? He reigns. He reigns supreme. Everything. And over everything. We give you the highest praise, Lord. We give you all thanks. We welcome you into this space. Hallelujah. We give you all the glory. All of the praise.
All the glory, and we give him what he is due today. Hallelujah. Once again, we do want to welcome you to Lighthouse Christian Center. We do not take it for granted that you have chosen to worship with us today, both in person and online. So we thank you for your viewership, for your membership, and for your presence. Amen.
Amen.
We welcome everyone to today's service. We wanted to let you know that, as always, a CD is available, or a digital download of today's service is available for you. You would just need to see Brother Brown at the back sale table, and he can get that taken care of for you. The CD orders take about a week, but if you would like one, they are available for you.
Amen.
Our LCC virtual Bible study will take place this Wednesday at 7 p.m. You can log on to the Bible study through Zoom. It's a link that we send out every week for that. But then you can also view the Bible study on YouTube as we stream it there as well. But you are welcome. You are encouraged to join us this Wednesday at 7 p.m. for LCC's Bible study. Amen? Children's Church is today. We invite all the children that are here today to join Sister Carolyn in the classroom after special musical selection, so that you can have Children's Church learn about Jesus Christ in your own way. Amen?
Amen.
We welcome any first-time visitors. If you would, please fill out a visitor's card before you leave. Make sure that you pick up a free gift before you leave as well. And any virtual visitors, please make sure that you connect with us on our website at www.lighthousesc.org. Click on the contact tab so that we can connect with you, reach out to you, and we bless you for your viewership. We thank you. A highlight of Black history. We do know that this month is Black History Month. So a highlight for today is Lot Carey. He was born in 1780 and lived to 1828. The trailblazer was born into slavery. Lot Carey's resilience and faith in God inspired change. After purchasing his freedom and learning to read the Bible, he became a Baptist missionary and led the first Baptist missionaries into Africa, eventually settling into ministry in Liberia. Carey's unwavering trust in God and the face of adversity remains a testament to his unwavering faith. We thank God for him.
Amen.
And others like him.
Amen.
He remains in the face of adversity. Amen. We want to give an opportunity for you to prepare your offering envelope. If you need one, please raise your hand and one will be provided for you. Thank you for those who have already given online. We have various ways to give. You can give in person. You can give via Cash App, Zelle. To use Zelle, you just need to use the church's email address, lighthousesc777@gmail.com. Or you can give on our website at www.lighthousesc.org/donate. Once again, we want to give you an opportunity to prepare your envelope. If you do need one, please raise your hand now. We'll have an offering scripture for you and then a song while you prepare your offering. The offering scripture today comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7. The New International Version reads as follows. Each of you shall give what you have decided in your heart to give,
Amen.
Not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And we know that this is just telling us how God views our giving, how what we give and what we have to offer to him brings us closer to him. When we give, you know, in Matthew 6 and 21, the Bible says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So we know that God is looking at our hearts. He's looking at what we, not what we have to give, but how we feel when we give. If we're giving out of obligation, if we feel like we're giving because it is what God loves us to do and loves us to do it so cheerfully. Amen?
Amen.
We'll have a song.
Your amazing,
so amazing. our Savior and our Redeemer, we come to you with hearts filled with gratitude this morning for the blessings that you give us each and every day. We know, Lord, that cheerful giving is not an obligation, but a joyful act of worship unto you. Lord, help us understand that our giving is an expression of our deep love for you and what you want on earth to further your kingdom here, Lord.
Yes.
Lord, we thank you for all you do for us. We thank you for your many blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We welcome the praise and worship team back to the stage for a special musical selection. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. How many of you know we serve a God that cannot fail? Amen.
Amen.
Believe that. Hallelujah. We bless you. Cause he won't fail. So we trust that everyone had a great week and a fun week. Hopefully you enjoyed the good weather. You know, it's been up and down. And hopefully you enjoyed the good health. I know some of you have been challenged with health.
Amen. You know,
issues and the flu and the strep and colds. And so you always stay bundled up. I know my father always tells me, said, and I forgot what I have today. He said, make sure you always have a change in shirt, man. Amen. Cover up yourself. Yeah. And do use some wisdom when you're sweating and out there and open, especially when it's cold.
Amen.
So
Amen.
We thank God for an awesome weekend. We trust that today will be a blessing as well. Let's just go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you. We give you praise. We give you honor. We give you all the glory. And we declare, Lord, that you will not fail.
Amen.
You never failed us yet. Yeah. You are absolutely undefeated. Thank you for your presence that is already here in the person of the Holy Spirit. We sense your presence here, and we thank you. We wouldn't want to do anything without you.
Yes.
And we thank you for everything that has been said, done, the opening prayer, the praise, the worship, the giving. And Lord, we pray that you will continue to move, even back in the classroom with the children and for the remaining part of the service. We pray that lives will be changed forever through the power of your word. Yes. Touch, heal, deliver and set free. That is our prayer this morning.
Yes.
In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, 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 and amen. So I don't believe I'm going to be before you long. As you can recall, we began a series this month about giving. I wanted to just pause just for 1 week to touch on the subject of marriage.
Yes, sir.
This is National Marriage Week, actually. It takes place every February in America from the 7th to the 14th. You know, 14th. The 14th is Valentine's Day. So we want to touch on this a little bit just for 1 week. I do realize everyone may not be married. Everyone may not want to be married. But I think it would serve us well at least to take one Sunday or 1 week to minister to those of us who are married, those who may be contemplating marriage, those who are married again, and to find out what the Word of God says. And we'll dig into this a little bit more. So we want to be in Colossians chapter 3, verses 18 through 19. We'll teach on this subject this morning, and then we'll touch on it again Wednesday, and we'll go back to our regular series on giving and generosity. So Colossians chapter 3, verse 18 and 19. A lot of these verses I memorized out of the King James. I want to read this one out of the Message Bible, and I think it really amplifies the text here, and it really digs a little deeper into what I believe the Apostle Paul was trying to communicate to the believers. It says in Colossians 3, verse 18 and 19, it says, "Wives, understand and support your husbands by submitting to them in ways that honor the master." Husbands, go all out in love for your wives. Don't take advantage of them. And so, again, we're talking about marriage. Just to give you a definition, we know marriage is a God-ordained covenant between a man and a woman. It is a lifelong, sexually exclusive relationship. It is also a relationship marked by faithfulness, sacrificial love, and joy. Okay, it's a relationship that mirrors the relationship between Christ and the church. And as we said, this is National Marriage Week. We understand, you know, the Valentine's Day is coming up. And in this passage here, the Apostle Paul, he wrote to the church at Colossae. It has been said that he didn't actually visit Colossae, but he wanted to take time to write to them, to encourage them in their faith, give them wisdom, and give them some biblical instruction about life. How many of you know we all need practical biblical instruction about how to live? And so he thought it necessary, he made it a priority to write to them. It's been said that Epaphras was the disciple there who was probably from that area, and he probably was the one who was responsible for sharing the gospel there. So Paul wanted to kind of supplement what he was sharing and make time to give them spiritual tools they need to live. And we need that today as well. You know, when we're in church, praise God for that. You know, God gives us the word. We come and praise and we worship our God. But after the benediction, we have to live. You know, we go back home. We go to work. We go in our families. And so we have to deal with the everyday challenges of life. And so the Bible gives us practical wisdom and insight on how we can live. And specifically, Paul was talking about how we should conduct ourselves in a marriage union. Now, I will say that We mentioned that marriage is a God-ordained covenant, covenant between a man and a woman. And so I want to share that according to the Bible, when you talk about marriage, it is between a man and a woman. It is between a male and a female. And there's no disrespect to the LGBT community, but I do feel that here at this church, we do need to make clear what our stance is.
That's right.
And not only that, I do feel, because there is an intentional effort to normalize all types of lifestyles, and respectfully, I do disagree, because the world has their opinion, and let's face it, same-sex marriage is on the rise. The approval rating of same-sex marriage is also on the rise, but I believe as the church, we do need to push back on that a little bit. You know, based upon what the word says, Pastor Graham, why do you say that? Do you not know that there are denominations that are split on this one issue?
Walk past
this one issue. They are churches in litigation going to court over property on what they're going to do with this one issue. I know pastors who have lost jobs, pastors who had to go find another job at another congregation because of this heated debate with this topic. Here at LCC, we will only perform weddings for couples who are male and female. We won't perform same-sex marriages here. And again, it's no disrespect to those of that persuasion, but in a respectful sense, I have to stand on what the Word of God says. I have to disagree. I have to base our decisions here based upon the conviction that we see in the Word of God.
That's
and
right.
So when I talk about marriage, understand I'm talking about that this is a covenant between a man and a woman, male and female. Go back to the Garden of Eden. It wasn't Adam and Steve. It's Adam and Eve. So we want to make that abundantly clear. So Paul, he went on to say that if we're going to address this subject, we have to make sure we understand the roles in a marriage. If I can back up a little bit, you know, some may ask, well, Pastor Graham, in addition to it being National Marriage Week, in addition to, you know, Valentine's Day being around the corner, what prompted you to talk about this subject? Well, I'll share this with you, because I will say I have been troubled. I talked to a lot of Christians, I talked to a lot of pastors, and I have been troubled and worried, if you will, about a lot of the things I've seen in Christian marriages. I have colleagues in the ministry who have gone through a lot of things, and sometimes the general public or the regular parishioner, they don't really know about it, but I talk to these guys and these ladies in private, and they tell me some of the things that are taking place in their families, in their marriages, and it is very, very troubling. It's something that is very concerning. I'm talking about people who are in the fivefold ministry. I'm talking about apostles, bishops, prophets, evangelists, people who are leading people to the Lord every single week. I'm talking about people who've been in the ministry for 10, 15, 20 years, and they're having a lot of struggles. I can remember years ago where there was a notable pastor. If I said his name, you would know him. And he was an excellent Bible teacher. And it shocked me, it surprised me that after 30 years, he and his wife divorced. There was another pastor who wanted to be married again. And went through a divorce and was believing God, really wanted to get married, and actually did remarry. And within 5 years, it was over. And how it was over, it was troubling, very messy, very contentious. And they're in litigation right now. And so when you see these things, it makes you have the standpoint that this isn't something we don't need to ignore. This is something we need to talk about, church.
Yes,
this is something we need to address. You know, the reality is, you know, there are challenges. We can give you example after example. I was talking to a lady, a Christian. These are believers. And the things I hear going on, even in Christian relationships. I know there's a lady and she dated a man 10 years and you know, she said, you know, Pastor Graham, called Mr. Graham, because, you know, I used to work with her. And she said, the first marriage, I didn't marry someone who was saved. And so this time around, I actually happened twice. Two ladies came to me from North Carolina and said, you know, I didn't get married someone who was saved. I wanted to, you know, go after a saved man this time. I want to have someone who's in the body of Christ this time. I said, yeah, you know, that's something good.
Come on, Pastor, walk.
However,
These two ladies had a Christian man. One was in the ministry, doing the most unthinkable things. Unthinkable things. Broke their heart. Said, Pastor, and he out there sleeping around again. I mean, I'm talking about someone who's in church every week.
Walk past.
Who's ushering, who's serving on our boards. I dare say, sometimes preaching. He said, I caught him again, Pastor. I said, caught him again.
So holy.
He said, I don't understand how he can do this. I don't understand how he can go to church every week. I don't understand how he can preach to people and do this. And so when I hear these things, I say, you know, we probably need to address this. We need to talk about this, at least for 1 week. Yes. We would be served, well served, discussing this. Now let me say this, although, you know, Carol and I have been married 21 years, I don't have all the answers. Say it up front, full disclosure. I'm still climbing. I'm still growing. I'm still looking at the mirror. I'm still praying that prayer. Lord, please make me a better, help me be a better husband. Help me be a better father. Help me be a better family man. I still glean from men who I perceive to be family men, men who love their wives. I hang around them. I read their books. I listen to their sermons. I go to lunch with them. I listen. I try to put whatever they're doing that works for them in my spiritual tool belt. Because how many of you know we all need that positive peer pressure to help make our lives better, our families better? Absolutely. That's what we need to attach ourselves to. People who are committed to God, but they're also committed to their family.
Yes, Pastor.
Unfortunately, in this day and age, that's few and far in between.
Yes.
I have learned that I put it on me. I can be a good pastor and a bad husband.
Come on now.
I can be a good teacher and a terrible father.
Come on.
It doesn't overlap. It doesn't spill over. You would think it would influence the other, but oftentimes that is not the case. And so just like I spend time in the Word of God, just like I spend time trying to prepare for sermons every single week, I need to spend time working on myself, finding out what the Word of God says or what my responsibility is and how I can become the best version of myself for my family. And this is an ongoing thing. You start, you keep improving yourself and growing till you go be with the Lord.
Amen.
And if I can, I don't want to ahead myself, but at the end of the day, both husband, wife, male, female, we have to pattern ourselves after the character of Christ.
Yes, Lord.
To be more and more like you.
Man, I got it.
That's what we have to do. It's not about how many scriptures we can rattle off. It's not about how good we can sing. It's not about how well we can move a crowd when we get in front of the pulpit. It's about what we're living.
Yes.
That is the true test. The word that I preach, the scriptures that I know, the ones in the Bible that I've memorized, is it taking root in my life? Am I growing? Am I bearing fruit? Am I becoming more and more like Jesus? Because talk is cheap. So that's why he says, this is something we have to be committed to do when we talk about marriage. So first and primarily, Paul says, I want to explain the roles in a marriage. We're assuming we have two covenant people. We're assuming we have two people who love God, committed to Christ. But after we get beyond that, there are roles. Now, it's kind of like a job description. You look at jobs and they describe what they want you to do, and then you got a choice to make. This, do I qualify? This is something I want to do for 8 hours a day, 40 hours a week. And some of the job descriptions say, nope, can't do that, don't want to do that.
That's it.
Definitely don't want to do that. And so you veer away and you do something else.
That's real.
Well, here he says, there are certain roles or descriptions that God expects us to do in a Christian marriage.
Yes.
And so we have to decide, are we up for the job? Is this something that we want to do? If not, we don't have to get married. I don't have to be in a relationship per se. But if we're going to do it God's way, he said, this is what I want to do. So he starts off by saying, wives, understand and support your husbands. And so in a Christian marriage, the wife is to understand and support her husband. Notice it said, by submitting to them in ways that honor the master. So
The wife is supposed to understand, get this, and support her husband. Pastor Graham, what does that mean? That means as a wife, you believe in your husband.
Yeah.
Okay? You support him. Okay? You believe in what he can do. You believe in what God can do through him. Hey, women, you need to be with the man that you believe in.
Yep.
Come on.
Talk to the lady here who is dealing with the trifling man. And yeah, I call him trifling because I call him that to his face. I let him know up front. That's just ridiculous what you're really doing. Yep. And really, this point here would answer the question. You know, is this a man you believe in?
Yeah.
Hey, this is a man that you can trust. Is this a man that you would trust to lead your family? This is a man you're willing to follow, to get behind him and support him. This is important. This is key.
Yes.
I would argue, women, that outside of deciding to make Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, choosing a husband, if you decide to do so, is the most important decision you could ever make in life, because you're not deciding who you're going to get behind and who you're going to believe in and who you're going to support. And that's why during the dating process, you ain't just going in and out of bed. You're checking him out.
Teach, pastor.
Because I need to see if I can believe this guy. This is someone who's worth me giving my time, support, effort, and energy to. That's why when you're in the dating process, man, it's like a job interview.
Yeah.
Yeah, you asking the tough questions. Yes, you are checking out, hey, his references. Talk to his family. Talk to his friends. Talk to his homeboy. Hey, talk to his pastor.
Yes.
Providing that he has one. Okay?
Hopefully.
And have a good personal comment. Yes, do you have a pastor? You know, are you a member of a church? And are you a member in good standing? See, and so he says, you have to find someone you can believe in.
Yeah.
Find someone you can support. And then he says, support them. Believe in him by submitting to them in ways that honors the master. Now, that word submit, you know, isn't a cuss word in the body of Christ, but it just simply means to yield or to be under rank. I'm going to show a clip, hopefully this Wednesday, Dr. Miles Monroe. It is excellent. A video about marriage, how he breaks it down and explains it. And he says, you know, running a family is like running a business or a corporation. And he says, wife, you are the VP, you're the vice president.
Yeah.
Husband is the president. That's why families, you got to have family meetings. The children are on the board of directors. You know, that's why a husband, you don't just make decisions, you check with the VP too.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
The vice president. That's why as vice president, you actually, yes, you have an opinion, you weigh in on what you can see. You let your board, children know what y'all decide to do as well.
Yep.
But it says, you are under rank, but you do have value. You're the vice president. You yield to the leadership of your husband. And notice he said, doing this honors the master. And now, he goes on to say, for husband, somebody say husband. Now, let me say this before I get started or finish up. I'm halfway done.
Come on, sir.
Notice he's talking to wives.
Yes.
He's talking to husbands.
Yes, sir.
He's not necessarily talking to just women and men. He's talking about people who are in the covenant of a relationship. In other words, he's saying every woman doesn't, first of all, women just don't submit to men in general. That's clear, especially when you look at it in the Greek. And women need to, if they are a wife, understand, support your husband, and submit to them. If you're just a girlfriend, this doesn't apply to you.
Yeah.
Okay? I told a young lady, I said, now you do know, because you're dating, you're hoping to get married, you are not married yet. As you do know that as a woman, you don't give your boyfriend husband privileges. You know that, right? It's because you're not married yet. He hasn't entered into a covenant with you.
Yeah.
This ain't called preaching, right?
Come on.
He said, you know, there are certain privileges and rights you have once you're married, and as a woman, you don't give boyfriend wife privileges. And also on the flip side, as a woman, you don't submit to just the leadership of a boyfriend. He's specifically talking to wives and husbands.
Now, we do live in a day and age, and again, we gotta push back against the culture a little bit.
Come on.
Because you have more and more Christians and believers, or just people in general cohabiting. We have people who don't even believe in marriage. We're gonna talk about that.
What?
You know, you could argue that maybe we've given marriage a bad name.
Yeah.
And judgment begins at the house of God.
Yeah, right.
Back in 1960, we're gonna look at some data as well. We had about 5% of Americans cohabiting. In the 2010s, that statistic rose to 60%, 5% to 60%.
Wow.
And so some people have given up on marriage. Now, I've given a lot of stats on marriage before. I'm going to give you some positive ones, but I do want to leave this on a positive note. I've given the negative stats.
Come on.
All right? How the divorce rate is high. I've given the negative stats about how the average marriage lasts only 7 years. I've given, you know, stats, but I want to give you some positive ones. But here I want you to see that Paul is talking to wives and husbands. Then he goes to the husband, and he says, as a husband's husband, go all out. Somebody say all out.
All out.
Go all out in love for your wife. And he said, don't take advantage of them. Go all out for them. For your wife, not just your job, not just your sister or your mama or your friends or your homeboys. He said, you go all out for your wife. In other words, you know, once you're married, she now becomes a priority. I also realize that when you go all out for your wife in love, this is something that must continue throughout your life.
Amen.
In other words, as a husband, you can never let your love grow cold.
Yeah.
The older sister says, son, the same thing you did to get her, you're going to do the same thing to keep her.
That's it.
And so you gave her flowers when y'all were dating, and when you took her out on dates, when y'all were courting, guess what? You better do the same thing after you say I do.
Go ahead, sir.
He said, you have to go all out for her.
Yes, sir.
Many times, and listen, I've been guilty too, as men, because we're very, you know, we're serious about our work. Sometimes our work becomes our identity, and we go all